Craig Cameron, Gloves Red, delighted to be joined by Ben McGivern. Ben, how are you getting on, okay?
I'm not bad, yourself, Craig?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good, Ben. Listen, thanks very much for taking the time to speak to us. It's a pleasure, as always. I caught up with you briefly after your fight at Hamilton Accy Stadium, so it was good to meet you there. So thanks again for doing an interview with us tonight. But Ben, I just wanted to, I suppose, gives everyone an insight into you as a person and a boxer, and I know you've came pretty late into the kind of pro game. So what I wanted to do was kind of start from you as a boy, you at school. Like, what were you like? Could you give people kind of an insight into what you were like at school and why you got into boxing?
Well, it wasn't at school. I was a wee pest. I was always wanting to be nagging the teachers and stuff like that, but just a normal kid that was a bit bad at school, getting with the wrong crowd at school and doing the wrong things, and it wasn't until I met an older boy that I started jumping about with and slid away for the ones I used to jump about with. And for there, it was I went back and forth to his house, he came back to mine, and we were playing football together, and he'd done a bit of the boxing. And it wasn't until he says, "Why don't you come and you can come and do a bit of boxing?" I'm like, "Ah, it's not really my thing. I'd rather play football." And he's like, "You don't know unless you try." So it went like that. He took me down to the bar, and I went through the doors, and obviously, it's everything else. You walk in and you're dead shy, and people are asking you questions, what you want to do with your life and stuff like that. And you're like, I don't know. But I went in, and after that first day, I didn't really get back. And then it wasn't until, I think it was a week and a half later, nobody was about, and I went, I'm bored. So I went down myself and I went through, and I just picked up a pair of gloves and I started tipping the bags and just for out of boredom.
Yeah.
So it was just out of boredom, and I went down and started hitting the bags, and that's all I used to do it for, boredom. Just if my pals weren't out and I wanted to go out and I had nobody around about me, it was out, then I would get down to the barn. And that's when Rab obviously seen me get in and out. And he pulled me to the side and he says to me, "Listen," he said, "Be sure name me, man." I was like, "It's Ben McGivern." He's like, "Well, listen, Ben," he says, "this is a boxing club, not a playground." He says, "People come in here to train and learn the sport. Are you interested in boxing?" And to have somebody come up to you and say that, and I didn't want to say no, because I didn't want to be cheeky. And I went, "Aye, I want to be, I'm interested." He says, "Well, listen, I'm not wanting you to waste your own time, and I'm not wanting you to waste my time." He says, "I put a lot of time and effort into this club." He says, "And I bring champions in, I make champions in this club this season. That's the way it's staying. So before you leave here," he says, have a good think to yourself what you want to do. He says, "And come back. After you don't want to do it, don't step through the doors again." And do you know, the words stick in my head day in, day out. And that's what made me get back there. And for that day, I never left the gym.
So did the football take a bit of a...
I wasn't really good at football. It was just another thing to keep me busy, keep me off the streets, as it like jumping about, going, do you know what I mean, doing kids things, stupid things. So it kept me busy. But football just got put to the side, because again, I was never really good at that. And as I say, I went back down to the barn, and I done as Rab says, stick in at it, and I learnt, and I learnt, and I learnt off each person that was in the box. And I made not only friends, I made family out there.
Yeah, and what can you tell us a bit more about, like, what was Rab like as a trainer? So for people that maybe, when you're talking about Rab there, Rab Bannon, someone that's highly respected and helped Ben a lot, and the likes kind of Ricky Burns as well, and you know, was highly respected in the local area. But could you give us like an insight? And you touched on it there with, you know, the fact that he wanted to raise champions and take the sport serious and learn the craft of boxing. But give us an insight into what was Rab like? Was he like a kind of father figure, but he was quite a disciplinarian? Or
right, he definitely was. Rab, well, for somebody to come to me and pull me to the side and give me the words like, this isn't a playground, this is where I make champions and stuff like that. It was a bit of discipline. And in my life at that time, I never had. So it was me taking a step back. Like, I quite like to be spoke to me, and I like that bit of truth. Like, you come and you put your 100% into this, or you don't come back again. And that's what it was, a bit of discipline. I think it was about everything, because it's like, if I'd done something at school, I would get told not do it, don't do that again. But then I would go home and get let out. So the discipline wasn't there. Mm-hmm. So at some point, but when I'm doing there, and Rab is, he was dead forward, and he told you how it was. I went down, and I continued went down, and I grew to know him as a person, and he took all his time out. He took his time out to help me, show me how to put a pair of gloves on, how to throw a jab. He introduced me to different people that was training in the gym. And now I had the likes of Ricky Burns at the time training in there, Martin Watson, Thomas Cannon, and stuff like that. And he introduced me to them. And he's like, this is what you could be if you stick in. And he used Ricky Burns as an example. He says, this is my top laddie. And he pointed to Ricky. And now look at him. Do you know what I mean? Three-time world champion. So that's the kind of examples he would use. And he always says, I don't want any trouble in this club. He says, it's just discipline. What I say goes. So Rab is a kind of a father figure in that role, as well as my boxing coach.
Yeah. And do you think that Rab and that kind of guidance, and the fact that you stuck in at the boxing, Ben, do you think that maybe stopped you from getting into kind of more bother? You were saying you kind of get into a bit of trouble when you were younger.
It did, well, as I say, I went to high school, and I got myself in a bit of trouble in high school with fighting. And the first thing I thought, I was fighting, I got chucked out of school, and I went. It wasn't the fact that I was going to upset my mum and my dad, or that it was the fact, or no, what's Rab going to think about this? Because obviously, when you get into the club, Rab always says, what I learn you, do not take outside.
Yeah.
You're always using the ring, so... The first time I ever went to school and I got in a bit of bother and started using my hands, I was more thinking along the lines of what's Rab going to say about me using my hands. So I was more worried what he had to say rather than anybody else. But as the time went on, Rab's and I went down, and I says to Rab, I says, listen, I says, I've been in a bit of bother at school. I says, I've been chucked out, and he says, right. He's like, sit and tell me the truth. He says, I want the truth. He says, what happened? He says, listen, one of the boys in the day, I started getting a bit cocky, a bit lippy. I says, as you know, when people start to see that you're doing well for yourself and stuff like that, they start to pick on you. I says, and that's all it was. You think you're a boxer, try to push me about that. I says, he just pushed me that limit. I says, and I end up whacking him. I says, but obviously, as I thought, how many teachers have seen it. I says, so the teachers seen it, and they've took me to the headmaster, and obviously I get suspended for 7 days. I says, well, you told me the truth. He says, and listen, it's not good, obviously, as I says, don't use your what I teach you out there. He says, but it's not good also where people try to pick on you. I says, no, I get that. He says, it's discipline, it works both ways. He says, well, what you're doing now that you're not at school. I says, I'll be just sitting in the house. He says, if your mum and dad let you, tell them like you can do in here, and I'll you can train alongside me at 2 o'clock. I was like, right, okay, so that's what I've done. And then just with the extra couple of years, I got to know Rab that bit more and more. And he always told me, says he goes to Teague, is in there 7 days into the boxing. It was only him that used to train a Saturday. And then he would go to church on a Sunday. And stuff like that, and just wee things like that added up. And the more I got to know him, the more respect and the more like love we got, what I got for him.
Yeah. Aye, and I was lucky. I done a podcast recently with Ricky and asked him like his best memories of the barn, and he said that his early memories were like 40 or 50 wee guys just basically having square goes with gloves on, obviously, and then you'd get a chalk ice at the end of the session. I was laughing just imagining that in my head, just being absolute carnage.
Well, I don't know if you've seen what I put on my Instagram. I think it was Wednesday.
Right.
I was at work and one of the workmates came up and he's like, here. Well, I've not seen these for years, right, Craig, honest to God. And he's like, you want my shoes, like Scholies and whatever. He gave me a chalk ice. The first thing it came to me was Ricky was saying, my chalk ice, you used to get into the sparring lights. So you used to come in Monday to Friday. And if you obviously, and Friday was the only busiest day ever because I gave chalk ices out, believe it or not. You wouldn't see anybody but Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then come Friday. It was Thursday, Friday, everybody would be doing there so they could get a chalk ice.
Yeah.
But they were all, as Ricky says, honest to God, you've been sparring. You probably had a 16-ounce glove on the right hand and a 10-ounce glove on the left. Honest to God, it was we had a box outside the ring with hundreds of gloves and with lockers with all different things in it, like old t-shirts, trackies, just safer stuff that you put you fire on, you know, if you're about to lose weight. And that, and then obviously it's just, as Ricky says again, with the chalk ices, rap, blah, right, oh, right, time, come on, kitchen. And honest to God, you'd a pile of boxes like that, you just fire out chalk ices every Friday.
Brilliant, that's absolutely brilliant.
It's just the memories like that. Just when I get fired at and work, I'm just like, Jesus, man, how much memories it brought back.
Yeah, it's funny how, I think not just in boxing, but life in general, when you think about like the past, it's always like wee things that you think of that made you kind of happy at the time. And it's funny how both you and Ricky are like, oh, what about this chalk ice at the end of the session in the kitchen or that?
It was the chalk ices and the stories behind that. Obviously, not him, it's the stories he used to tell. And honestly, and any wee tricks he used to try and do. He was a comedian as well as a good man.
No, it sounds like a legend. Just sadly missed, you know, just someone that obviously, you know, taking people, they talk about a lot of boxing people say taking people off the streets and keeping them out of trouble and giving them that discipline. And I suppose it speaks volumes when you get into trouble at school when you were thinking, oh, no, what's Rab going to say? You know, but you were honest with them and showed them that respect. And I think he's obviously recognised that and kind of took you under his wing to an extent, which is great. So then, like, see from there then, so you get into boxing, discipline, you're training with Rab, and you've got kind of guys like Ricky and stuff in the gym to look up to. So can you tell us a bit more about maybe progressing into the amateurs and, I suppose, what you're kind of mostly proud of in your amateur career?
As Rab is saying, he's like, right, so this is my top boy, like Ricky, and we've got Thomas Cannon, that's their Scottish champions and stuff like that at the time. He says, and if you stick in and you do what I tell you, then you can become what they are. Mm-hmm. And I was like, obviously at that time, I was like, right, okay, just take it all in. Because at that time, I never knew what a Scottish champion was. I never knew, do you know what I mean, who these boys were, and like Ricky and that. And like Ricky's brothers used to train there as well, David and Adrian. But Adrian left for football, I'm sure. And then the guy that I'm pally with, that I was talking about earlier on, David Ellis Cooley, that's who took me into the boxing. And that was about my age group. And just along the ways, and that's, I learnt off them, and just grabs that, right, so if you put the hard work in, he says, I can get you fights, you need to show me that the hard work's paying off, can you come into my office, and Rab used to take your weight down in a day. He's still done it just not a long ago before he passed, when I went back down. He's like, right, you give him stand on the scales, and I stood on, and I'll just say 60 kilo, right? I'll just say I think it was 9 stone. But that was my amateur weight, but we use that. And he's like, right, he says, I would want you down to 51. He says, before you can fight. He's like, right, okay. He's like, if you can prove to me that you can get down to there, I'll get you a fight. He says, right, okay. And So we went and I started getting shown how to throw a jab, move ahead, the slip, the snarl, the, everything I was getting shown. It says it's a lot to take in. So, cut a long story short, I learnt the basics. Rab's seen that I was training hard. I was in day in, every day. And Rab turned around and says, right, we've got you a fight. Now, he says to me, I've got you a fight on Saturday, the 17th of August, just say. So, Saturday, the 17th of August, was like a week on Saturday. So I'm like, Jesus Christ, he was like, where do I hang? He's like, you need shorts and you need boots. I says, right, okay, where do I get the info? So I was flung in the deep end, and I'll never forget, I went into, before, in a school, I can't remember, it was like a novice show. You had to have 10 novice fights before you could actually compete. So I went in there and I had my first fight, and I was swinging like mad, and I can remember just getting somebody in the headlock. Started doing that with him. Honest to God. And my arm was getting stuck. I was on the rope and I was just swinging. See, I get showed it by. It was, oh, honest to God. It was a guy called Scott Ferguson for the Orbison Boxing Club, I thought, for the, my first fight.
Aye. So you put him in a headlock?
I got my headlock. It was that. Honest to God. Put my headlock and the rest of that. Well, you can't do that. And then I combined a big wild punches and my arm gets stuck on the rope, the wee bit of the rope. So I'm just swinging this big left hand like that. Honest to God. Magic. I won the fight, right enough. I won the fight. But I went back and Rab's like, he's like, you done well, he says, but Jesus Christ, what were the big windmills all about? I told you to box. I'm a wee
ass. Stick to your jab, not the windmill. So I believe you, like, you stepped away from the sport for a while, didn't you? Like, what was the reason for that, Ben? And what brought you back?
I stepped away after I had about 40 odd amateur fights after that, and it was just 40 odd amateur fights. I stepped away after winning the Scottish and that, and just again high school getting away, and I met new pals, and you know, at that age you start to see other things in life, and before you know it, the boxing's at the back of your mind rather than the front, and then your pals are doing this and it looks good. And so I went and started doing my own stuff and I forgot all about the boxing side of me. I think I was too engrossed into what my new pals were telling me, what they were up to and what they were doing. And I got sucked into what they were telling me. So I ended up going with them Friday night, Saturday night. Before I know it, I get involved in this group and I started drinking, I started going out on the weekends, I wasn't going into Sunday, and then I looked back at it and I went, and it wasn't until somebody says to me, he's like, Ben, what are you doing with your life? He says, 1 minute you're boxing, you're doing well for yourself, and then you're away off of school. And I was like, I had a myself going, you're right, you know what I mean? I get chucked out. And the more it went on, I started getting angry with myself, and I went, how can I get down and face that man? It promised me that he would make me a champion and he would put his time and effort into me, and then I just went and let me down. So that's how I slipped away, and it was the more I was keep telling myself I wanted to get down and face him, the more I was more stepping away, and I was just... One year led to two, and 2 year led to three, and before I knew it, it was 4 years, son, before I could step back and see him. Mm-hmm. And just because I let him down, I knew he would have been very disappointed. And obviously, I didn't think that he would have opened the doors and been as kind as he was when I went back down.
Mm-hmm. What was that first conversation like?
The conversation went in. How it started was one of my pals started back the boxing and he went down, and he says McGivern was about to come back down, but he's too on edge, obviously, for what you're going to say to him. He's like, tell him to come down and see me. He says there's no point in hiding away. So I built up the courage and I went down, and I've been doing my head down and looking at the phone. He's like, look at me. He's like, in him office, and get in the office, and he would shut it. He says, right, he's like, what did I tell you? I says, you told me a lot of things. I says, but one was never to go behind your back and do what I've just done. He says, right. He says, can you be honest with me and I'll be honest with you? I says, aye, I can be honest with you. He's like, why did you do it? I was like, I was too engrossed, obviously. I was at school, people were telling me they were doing this at the weekend and I wasn't doing nothing. So I get carried away but they were telling me more than about I was with the box. And I was like, so I ended up slapping away. He's like, are you away from him now? I says, aye. I says, because obviously I get pulled to the side and somebody says to me, he's like, what are you doing with your life, etc. And I was like, well, I might have got a good one. No, you're on the opposite side. I says, so I'm away from him. He's like, right. He says, get back. This was in the first day. He says, come back during the Monday season. We'll start again. And we'll hopefully we'll leave off for where you were before. This is right, okay. And that's when I went back down. And I never left again up to, I think it was about 17.
It shows he's a guy with a big heart, eh?
Well, it's like, the hardest part was is can do and saying to the guy puts every bit of faith in it, he's saying, listen, I've messed up because I didn't know the way that I took it, do you know what I mean? Because I knew that it wasn't one for people messing my boot, as he says. So it was hard to take, you know, and I let him down, never mind. Walk in and say to him, right, I hold my hands up, I let you down, I'm sorry. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? It's good. I think the hardest part about it was him telling me just to go back out the door and don't come back. After him get me amateur fights and get me so well in the Scottish and that.
What was that comeback like then, having to get fit again and get through that process? And I know that you fought before, like turning pro now, and you were fighting under the kind of Biba banner as well. How long was that before you were fighting that?
Well, I went back down and I had I was only about 14 when that happened, so I went back down and I had 14 to 17. So I had a good few years back with Ab. As I say, we went through the Scottish, the British, the four nations. And with that, what I've done is I dedicated everything that I put in the first session, right, and then the second when I went back, and he says, right, we'll do this again. So I put everything into it. And we got to where we got to in the four nations, and the British, and the Scottish, and the Westerns, because I know that I let him down, so I had to prove to him that I wasn't going to do it again. So back to the drawing board, right in the training, and that's where we wiped the floor with the amateur game. Yeah. We got gold medals after gold medals and went to the British and stuff like that. And Rab said to me one day, he says, right, it's time to step over to the pro game. I says, right, and we had Barry Hughes at the time, Brave Heart Promotions. So I was about to sign over with him, and some sort of background, I don't know, the ins and outs of it, it fell through anyway. And Rab phoned me when I was ready to go to the board in Glasgow, and he phoned me, says, right, McGivern, he says, just turn back, he says, it's fell through, I'm not wanting you to go to it. I was like, right, no bother. And just as that, I had my heart set on turning professional, and I've told everybody I'm turning professional. Still going to be hanging my phone now, because it was in the I was on Google and that. So I told everybody I was talking pro and stuff like that. Like, listen, that's brilliant for the life that you used to live, to the life that you're living now. Magic. And after hearing the words, it fell through. It was devastating, do you know what I mean? It was like a rock fell down on top of me. So I went back and Rab never really had an explanation. And I think after that, I was blaming Rab, it's just I think after that I went, this just isn't being. I went half rails again, and that was when I didn't go back. Yeah. So I didn't, and then I think I was about 17, 18 at the time, and then that was me right up to 10 years ago.
So So aye, it sounds as if your dream was there, you were in the car driving at your dream that you always wanted to do, and they just pulled the carpet from under your feet. Yeah, it must have
been. That's
awful. See in the amateurs, Ben, did you fight against anyone, you know, people watching this would know now, like any kind of big names and stuff like that?
Well, funny you say that. That debut I just had by Pucci had a fight 2 weeks after we fought. I'm sure they fought a guy called John McAllen.
Right.
Now, John McAllen's for Leaf. John McAllen's this amateur pedigree that's never been beat, right? So, just when I seen it, he was fighting Pucci, and I went, and Tommy Jacobs was on the show, and I went, oh, I see, McAllen's on the show, and Pucci messaged me, he's like, aye, heavyweight. And I was like, aye, he says, I've just been called in. He says, who again? He's like, John McAllen. He says, all right. I was like, I fought him at amateurs. He says, aye. He told me he beat you 4 times. I'm like, oh, did he? Aye. So, aye, he beat me 4 times. I'm like, honest God, this guy, right? I'm like, all right. So I've got the 4 articles that they hang me that I beat him. McGivern beats Edinburgh boxer, Scottish champion, John Boy McAllen. I says, right. And I sent him my 4 clips here. But McGivern beats McAllen. McGivern beats McAllen in points, beats him in Scottish and stuff like that. I says, send him out. I says, that doesn't look like 4 defeats. And I was like, it wasn't even 4. I says, I fought him 3 times. There's a 3 articles in the clips. I says, I only fought him 3 times and I beat him. I says, tell him it wasn't 4. And Tommy Jacobs messed me back. I says, aye, there's a boy down here that's beat you 4 times. I says, I've just spoke to put you about it there. I says, I've been fighting 4 times. I fought him 3. I was like, I says, in the early articles, I says, show him that. I says, if that's what he wants to call him winning. I says, but that's in black and white. I beat him. I says, and batter in. aye, but that loudmouth, I fought him. Gary McMullen, for Edinburgh and all, he was a good lad.
I know that's it's funny how some just from the past, and then you're like, oh, actually, that's not what happened. But no, it sounds like you had a really successful amateur career, and yeah, just unfortunate that happened in regards to the pros, because you know, if you get into it early, you don't know what would have been, you know. But well, it's such a hard pill for you to swallow at the time, Ben.
How I get back, I was sitting back and I was watching the boxing one night, and it was Paul Appleby. I thought Paul Appleby was amateurs as well. Paul Appleby was fighting John Simpson. I might be wrong, it might be John Simpson from Glasgow, isn't it?
Yeah.
Nah, it was John Simpson for the British he was fighting. They two were fighting. I'm like, Jesus Christ. And I was like, They're a guy that followed his dreams at the exact same time as I started. He started this season, look where he is, and I'm sitting barely out on my pellet bar, being I'm sitting going, I threw this away. And that's where I got back into the gym, and this is how the white collar scene came about, and then the white collar kicked about, and then it was at Bieber, and this is the road that I ended up on. But I knew myself, if I had to go to even British Boxing Board, they wouldn't have touched me with a pole. So I went down to Bieber, and it was just taking... I shouldn't have done it, because see, looking back at it now, see the videos and watching me fight, I'm like, Jesus Christ, people letting me get in that state should be shot in the head, do you know what I mean? You should never let anybody get in that state. I wasn't right in the head. But it wasn't until my trainer, the now, John Wilson, He phoned me, and he says, Ben, he says, can I have a word with you? No, I never knew John personally at this time. He says, aye. He says, I'll get a wee meeting with you. He says, right, no problem. So John pulled me to the side, and we met up. He says, listen, he's like, what you're doing to yourself, he says, is dangerous. He says, I've been watching you. He says, aye, you're getting in with tomahawks. He says, you're putting people to sleep. He says, but you're real. On the scale of 10, you already got hurt badly here. He says, you need to get looked after. He says, you're doing this after back your own. Do you know what I mean? I'm like, ah, fair play. And John's like, ah, I'll take it, I'll do your pads, and I'll make you lost weight, etc. And like, John never had a background in boxing himself, but for somebody to come off, take it off his own back to get a hold of me, just to tell me that, aye, it's good in what I'm doing, putting people to sleep, but for the wrong reasons, that I'm wasting my own talent. So John got a hold of me, and he started training me, and started getting me lost weight. And it wasn't until John says to me there, he says, now go for your British Boxing Board licence.
And you know, now you're signing for Kinnick. How did that come about then?
Well, I fought down in Essex under Tommy Jacobs with Bieber, and there was a boy that's fought on a British Boxing Board of Control. He's now got his license again. He's fighting down in Essex in 3 weeks. Navi Duran. Now, I fought him in an 8-rounder, and it was it was back to the barn with pure war, just punch for punch. He tried to overpower me. I took what he gave me, and then overpowered him. It was a war. It's a good fight, right enough. And then he thought he deserved to win it because I won it. I says, right, okay. He says, rematch over 10 rounds. He says, right, gave him a rematch. And this is what changed the whole point of where I'm at now. Is I haven't been there. John trained me again, and he got my boxing ability back. See the arm just going over for power. He made me box, so I've been doing there, and I keep watching it, and I'm just going, do you know something? There's something still in there. I watched the 10 rounds, and the boy couldn't lay a hand, a glove on me. I boxed the head off him, I used the jab, and see, watching it, I went, there's something still left in there. See, the right weight, there's something still left. And I went, I could still give this a good go. And just as that time, John says, well, why don't you get down the route of British Boxing Board of Control? And I went, I don't think they would touch me, obviously, with the background. Don't get me wrong, amateur, but the background is good, he says, but the off-scale, the white collar and stuff like that, I said, I don't think they'd touch me. So we got in touch with Sam, and Sam's like, listen, if you can get down to, I think he says, light heavyweight, he says, I'll sign you. And that's when I says to Sam, I was like, really? He says, aye. He says, well, if you want to give me that, if you want to sign me and you say, like, heavyweight, I'll give you one better. I'll go to super middle. He's like, you think you'll make super middle? He says, aye. And that's when he gave me an open mandate to do it. And I says, no, I'll give you one. And I've done it two, I think it was 2 weeks before the actual date that he gave me to make the weight.
Right, brilliant. Brilliant. So did you feel like that made up naturally at the time when the carpet got pulled away from you with the whole potential deal with Barry Hughes and you were a lot younger and stuff like that? But
Just after the, I couldn't believe it. Once Sam says that, and he's like, right. And I never says to anybody, I just went back to training and I lost the weight. I think it was about 3.5 stone or something I lost, maybe more. But I went back and I trained and I lost the weight, and Sam's like, he was shocked at the fact how much weight I lost and how quick I'd done it. And he knew, and I says, no, listen, he says, you've given me your word, I'll give you mine. I says, I'll put everything I've got left, I says, into this. I says, I'll train my heart out. I says, I won't let you down. He says, no, I says, but that's what I like to hear. So after that, the plan was to get back down to Rab. And I says to Rab, listen, I've just signed with British Boxing Board now. I would like you to be part of the journey.
Yeah.
So once Sam says, right, we signed the papers, we're done, went to the board, I got my medical, I went to Rab and I says, listen, I've got some news. He says, aye. He says, I've got my British Boxing Board. He's like, oh, Jesus. He's like, that's great. He says, obviously, it's been a long time coming. He says, aye. I says, I would like you to be part of it. He says, he turned around and said, in the, I can't remember the word he says. He used some word, and he's like, of course I would after it. I was like, bad. Obviously, that time I was like, says, I don't know a date as yet for my debut. And just as that, we got the date, and obviously, when I went to get in contact with Al, because we kept in contact on the phone, he was in the hospital.
Yeah. It couldn't have been nice for you to hear that, but in relation to the like turning pro and kind of keeping that to yourself, did you just feel that you started to get that kind of fire in the belly again? I mean, the fact that you had a challenge to make that weight and you were like, you know what, I'll do one better, I'll do super middleweight just to prove to you how much I want this, and you done.
Well, when somebody gives you that opportunity to achieve your dream, then if they say, right, there that day, in my heart, I'm going to go one better. I'm going to, because he's gave me his word. He's turned me professional with him. Do you know what I mean? But nobody else would have touched me, probably. With obviously the background. So I've ended up like that. No, I'll go one better. I'll work my ass off. I'll go down to super middle. So I'm glad that Sam took his time in and gave me that chance and opportunity. So that's why I get a season. No, I'm not too light heavy. I says I'll do one better and I'll go to super middle. So it worked out better for me.
Great. And so you had, just at the end of July, wasn't it, at the Hamilton Accies Stadium, and you fought Pucci, the legend that was Pucci. What was that experience like for you, that kind of first pro fight that you'd always dreamed of? And for me, I was there on the night. It was a great atmosphere, great venue. What was that experience like for you then?
Well, I can't put any words on how it was, because after it was all a blur. I had so many people come back to my life, you just ignored me. And I'm like, it was so much to take in.
Yeah.
After I spoke to you after the fight. But watching it back, and I've spoke to Pucci, and I've not got words to say how good it was, the feeling, because it was so much to take in. It was just to have that time and say, I've actually been there, I've done it, I've had my professional debut after so long being out the ring, having so much mountains to climb to get to where I'm at the day. But being in there with Pucci, I learned a lot of stuff in there, and I couldn't thank Pucci enough for giving me the four hard rounds.
Yeah, listen, I think he must have been a fan of yours, because he didn't only just copy your haircut, but he copied your shorts as well. So he must be a fan of yours.
No, dear, he's been watching me for years. No, I say he's a good character, no, but I couldn't ask for a better debut. Sharing with him in there, like, I watched it back and like, I learned a lot in there. Now I'm in the camp, I'm in the now, I'm learning on the stuff I went wrong in there, and I'm also adding to stuff that I don't okay in. Do you know what I mean? There's stuff I need to work on, a lot more to work on, but I'm just looking forward to my next one to put it all back in there and put another masterclass boxing show on.
Yeah, and so late start to the kind of pro game, Ben, you've explained why you're probably late starting. Some of that's not your fault either, but what's the biggest objective in your head? Like, you know, is there one thing that's, you know, you've got your eyes on before, you know, you get to an age where you need to kind of walk away from fighting?
Well, it's just, I promised myself that I'll give everything into it in the last, this year, next year, and hopefully the year after, because I was going to say 2 or 3 years last year, but obviously with lockdown, that put a damper on it, so I'm a year behind. So potentially I've been a professional for 2 years, but only really kick-started my career off this year.
Yeah.
But my main goal is to get as much fights as possible with whoever at super middle, or if the opportunity comes at a title nearer the time, even middle, I'll push down to middle. I just want to achieve as much things as possible in so short time.
Great. And your next fight has been announced, Ben. Do you want to tell everyone when that is and where it is and how they can get tickets for the fight?
9th October in Crown Plaza. Tickets obviously from Instagram, Ben McGivern Boxing, or Sam Kinnock. You can get them off Sam Kinnock.
Okay. And has there been an opponent named yet, or will that be maybe in a few weeks?
A few weeks, the opponent will get announced.
Okay, all right, great. But listen, Ben, I just want to thank you for your time and giving us an insight into not only your life and your career as well, and the kind of ups and downs with that, and being so honest and giving us insight into a legend like Rab Bannon as well, and what he's done for you. So I just want to thank you for that, and wish you all the best in your next fight.
Well,
and I'll be there, and hopefully can get a chat with you after the fight like I did with you.
Definitely. Okay, guys, thanks for having me again.
No bother. Right, Ben, take care. I'll talk to you soon.
Right, you too, pal, right?
All the best.